in your Bibles to Mark chapter 7 as we read the scripture, our passages this morning. If there is anyone here this morning that does not have a Bible, please raise your hand at this time. The ushers are coming forward to put a Bible in your hand. And once you find that Bible, go ahead and open it up to the Gospel of Mark chapter 7. Keep your hand high in the air so the ushers can see you. Up here in front, Beaudry, if you come up all the way to the front. Once you have your Bible, open it to Mark chapter 7. We're going to pick it up in verse 24. If you're new to Calvary Chapel, listen to me. We do not play hopscotch on the scripture. We don't go from Genesis to Revelations to Matthew to Luke. We take a book at a time, and we'll finish that book before we move on to something else. So we take the book, and then we take a chapter at a time. And then we take a verse at a time. So if you're with us today and you miss next week, you know that the week after, we're going to be in the same section. Why do we do this? To give you a comprehensive look at the Bible, to keep things in their context. That way you could see the whole scripture. The Apostle Paul says, Lord, I have given them the full counsel of God. And we find ourselves there. We need to do this as pastors and teachers, so we do that for you. Thank you, ushers, once again. Mark chapter 7, verse 24, reading from the New King James Version, God's word says this: From there he arose and went to the region of Tyre and Sidon, and he entered a house and wanted no one to know it, but he could not be hidden. For a woman whose young daughter had an unclean spirit heard about him, and she came and fell at his feet. The woman was a Greek, a Syrophoenician by birth, and she kept asking him to cast the demon out of her daughter. But Jesus said to her, Let the children be filled first, for it is not good to take the children's bread and throw it to the little dogs. And she answered and said to him, Yes, Lord, yet even the little dogs under the table eat from the children's crumbs. Then he said to her, For this saying, go your way. The demon has gone out of your daughter. And when she had come to her house, she found the demon gone out and her daughter lying on the bed. Church, you may be seated at this time. Again, if you're new or if you're not new, if you're part of our family, we want to welcome you here to Calvary Chapel, Montrose. We're glad that you're here with us to consider the scripture before us. This is what we do. We tear it up, if you may. We eat from it. We want to draw understanding. Yes, we want to understand the context. When was this written? What was going on during that time? But there's always, always an application for us. There is always a way we can find ourselves, such as he has left the main Jewish area. He is in the north, if you may. And so when we think about this, it's kind of like our picture, right? We're not in Israel. Now, some of us are going in a couple of weeks. Sorry you can't go, but we're glad that we're going. But we're not in Israel. And yet Jesus has reached out to us. He has come to where they speak English. He has come to where they speak Spanish. He has come where they speak all kinds of languages. Jesus went out of his way and goes out of his way to reach you and I. So while we're reading this, I want you to be thinking about that. My goodness, God, first of all, he came from heaven to earth to show us a way, right? And he has come to us here in Western Colorado to meet the needs that we have. Our needs, like others, are very real. And God, the God of the Bible, cares for you as he cares for me. As individuals, certainly as a group, but he cares for us. And, listen to me, he cares for your friends. He cares for your friends. And some of them are struggling. And some of them don't even know the Lord. Have not come close. Have perhaps never been invited to a church. But he cares for them. This morning, we have two events, actually. I don't think we'll get to the second one, but we'll cover them anyway next week, like I said. And they have to do with some miraculous healings of the Lord. But what makes this event different than the norm, if you may, is that Jesus, instead of just healing Israelites, here he begins to heal non-Jewish people. Application for us. The Lord just doesn't work in the Christian family. The Lord just doesn't work in the Christian church. The Lord will work with non-Christian people. He will work for them because he loves them, because he wants to draw them to himself, because he wants to reveal himself as God Almighty to the masses, to the people. Church, if you didn't know this before, I trust that today you will be encouraged of that fact, that you also can approach Jesus on behalf of somebody else. What? Are you saying I could be a proxy? Absolutely. Realize this, that you are welcome to come before the Lord and plead to him for your friends, as we have this morning. A woman pleading for her daughter. So let's begin. And we have the rest of Mark's gospel before us. The Syrophoenician daughter is healed. And today's message I've entitled, Persistent Faith Rewarded. So all through this, you're going to pick up, my goodness, this woman has faith. My goodness, she is still going on with it. She is still asking Jesus, in spite of her circumstances, in spite of her challenges, she is still seeking the Lord. You and I, we might not fare so well. You and I might be quitters. As we see what she is confronted with, perhaps it would be easier for you and I to walk away. But those that walk away would not receive the answer or the need filled for which they came for in the first place. So let's look at verse 24, the first part. God's word says this, from there he arose and he went to the region of Tyre and Sidon. Church, you have to love this about Jesus. He is the continual good teacher. You see, in our last time together, last week as we covered part of the scriptures, Jesus taught in verse 15 that there is nothing that enters a man from the outside which can defile him, but things which come out of him. These are the things that defile a man. So church, of course, Jesus was speaking of foods, saying that they are clean. Now think about the Jewish mind. Are you kidding? We can have bacon and pork chops? You know, this is a good thing, you know, because Jesus is saying we can eat of these things. But here, by purposely traveling to the region of Tyre and Sidon, primarily Gentile regions, he demonstrates that Gentiles are no longer common, or Gentiles are no longer unclean. And I say that because the Jewish leadership at that time, and any good Jew, you couldn't rub shoulders with just any other person in the marketplace. If you went to go buy a falafel or you went to go buy a whatever, you know, they would eat over there, and you happened to touch someone, oh my goodness, it was a big deal. You had to come home, you had to bathe, you had to wash, you had to go through all these ceremonial cleanings. And therefore, they would say, those guys are unclean, or don't approach those guys. Could you imagine if that was us today? Oh, you can't share with a non-believer. Oh, you shouldn't be hanging and watching football, watching Denver win this afternoon. No, just kidding. But you don't have to be doing this or that because they're unclean. No, Jesus taught just as food, you know, that the Gentiles are no longer common or unclean. So what's he doing? He is practicing what he had just taught the disciples. There is no difference between Jews or Gentiles, for all are sinners. All people are in need of a Savior. Would you agree? All people. So church, again, may his disciples learn that it wasn't just about the Jews. Though he did come predominantly to them, God cared and God cares today for all people. He came about 45 miles north from Capernaum so that he might have some privacy, perhaps some rest, much deserved rest with the guys. And note the second part of verse 24. He entered a house and wanted no one to know it. But he could not be hidden. Church, you have to love this, right? Jesus can be hidden. Isn't it not true that we're around that workplace or we're with someone else, and all of a sudden we say, my goodness, that person must be a Christian. They're so nice, you know? And we say this about someone else. Gosh, and you want to ask, are you a Christian? You know, we want to do that. Jesus cannot be hidden, and he should not be hidden in our lives. We should let our light shine for others, especially people who need kindness. We should do that for his sake. Okay, but notice that he did not go into a stadium, you know, or a synagogue. That was his way. He taught. And a stadium, he'd probably fill that stadium because we just read in our last time together, 5,000 men had been fed, and their wives and their children. I am sure if he had opened up or gone into a huge stadium that the people would have poured in to not only hear him, but certainly to receive of him. But he didn't do that. It says he entered into a private house and he didn't want anyone to know. Well, remember, church, that it was foretold concerning him that he shall not strive nor cry, neither shall his voice be heard in the streets. In other words, Jesus was not all about himself. This afternoon, you'll see touchdowns made, and the guys are going to come out of there, and as soon as they're on TV, I'm the man. Look at this, right? The Bible said that Jesus would not be this person. He would not be the one, hey, I'm the one that fed 5,000. Hey, come to me. I'm the one that's healed people. In other words, Jesus was not a person to toot his own horn. Are you? Are you that type of person that is following the world's example instead of Jesus' example? We are to be humble. We are to be the people that when people say, hey, man, thank you, you realize what you're... No, whatever. You know, people will come over here and they'll say, my goodness, we've never been inside your building. How did you do it all? And we say, hey, everybody got together and did it all. And if you were here, you remember all of us were painting, all of us were cleaning. We don't get the credit because we don't deserve the credit. If it wouldn't have been for the Lord, even the benches that are in the center here, they were a gift to us. They were a gift to us. All we had to do was go to California, eat some In-N-Out burgers, load up the trucks, and come back, right? And here they are. We serve a great God that has made it all possible. And so Jesus would never put himself on the limelight. We need to learn from that. When we get invited to go somewhere else to speak, or our worship team is asked to go somewhere else to speak, they don't go up there saying, yeah, we're the man. You know, we're from Calvary Chapel Montrose. It's not a good thing because Jesus didn't do it. And we're to be following his lead, not Hollywood's lead or someone else, if you may. So he did not go out and cry out his name or toot his own horn. Not that he wasn't willing to preach, or not that he wasn't willing to heal, you know, but where he was at now, it was up to the people to seek him out. It was up to the people to go and find him. Now let's make an observation here, church. As there is a time to appear, if you may, so there is a time to retire. He would not be so forward as he was for Israel's sake, whose glory he would be. But here upon the borders of Tyre and Sidon, among the Gentiles, he would not be so forward to show himself. He's in Gentile territory. Again, the last part of verse 24 states, but he could not be hidden. Look at verse 25. For a woman whose young daughter had an unclean spirit heard about him, and she came and fell at his feet. Let's stop there because this is just leaping out of the pages. A woman who heard. How would she hear unless someone was sharing what God had done? Perhaps she just heard, my goodness, Jesus had his disciples. They were in a deserted place, and all kinds of people poured out from the cities and regions and came, and they were hungry. It was late, and instead of him sending them home, he fed them. He is a man that can do great things. And you realize that there's a world out here. There's a community in Montrose who perhaps are carrying heavy burdens, and they haven't heard what Jesus can do. And so we are asked to share your story. Share your personal story, what God has done for you. What has he done for you? God has done incredible things for us. Those of us who are grandparents now remember when our own children were sick and those temperatures were 104 and 105 and we were panicking and we cried out to the Lord to heal them. And now we see our kids older and married and they have children. Now it's their job to panic, right? And they call, Mom, Dad, what shall we do? Pray. Pray. Ask God, who is the living God, to be involved in your kids' lives, right? Some of us were on drugs. Some of us could not put the bottle down. Some of us were always fighting in our homes until we asked the Lord, Lord, help us. Help us, Lord, bring peace into our homes. Help us, Lord, renew us. God can. And so when we share with others what God has done, they hear. This woman comes to Jesus because she had heard. And that's enough. That is enough to put her faith in action. Church, the Bible says that all of us have been given a measure of faith. And even if it's a small, little, teeny, weeny, little bit of faith, we can put it in action. And we find this woman here. So again, for a woman whose young daughter 25, had an unclean spirit, had heard about him, and she came and fell at his feet. 26, the woman was a Greek, a Syrophoenician by birth, and she kept asking him to cast the demon out of her daughter. Church, let's make some observations here for the purpose of you and I, understanding that, yes, there may be obstacles in the way that need to be overcome by faith to get what we need. Okay? This morning you came, and the first thing you looked at or you noticed outside, it's snowing. Lord, why do you always answer the ranchers and the farmers' prayer for more water? You know, those of us in the city, we're done with it. You know, I mean, good grief, but here it is, right? So that might have been an obstacle. I don't want to go. Some of you girls might have gone into your closet. This dress not going to work. These pants aren't going to work. Honey, I have no clothes, right? It's an obstacle, right? After you go through 25, 30 dresses, 10 pairs of shoes, you're thinking, I just don't have enough to go to church, right? It could be an obstacle, right? Some of you probably came out in click, click, and your car didn't start. Or when you came home last night, it died. And so you're saying, until I get a new car, I don't think I could make it, right? There's obstacles. Some of those were silly, of course, but you get the point. Let's make some observations what she went through. What are some of her obstacles? Number one, her nationality. Her nationality. She was a Gentile, and Jesus was a Jew, right? I mean, in those days, you think we have problems with the Hatfields and McCoys? You know, it was a big deal over there. It was, as you and I would say, the blacks against the whites. The Mexicans against the whites. Everybody against the Asians, right? And all of us hate the Arabs or whatever. I mean, it was crazy in those days. Today, those prejudices might be in, but the Lord's been working, right? They stay in. You know, God help us get rid of this junk, because we know that Jesus loves everyone in the world, right? But her nationality was against her. Okay, second obstacle for her, she was a woman, all right? Society in that day was dominated by the men. In the eyes of some of the guys, she was probably getting some mean looks. Like, woman, what are you doing here? You know, this is a man's world. You know, I don't know. But it's like, what are you doing here, right? So she was getting, that's an obstacle for her. She had to kind of make her way to the Lord. And what's driving her? My daughter, no one can help her. There is not a shingle in Montrose that says, we rebuke demons, right? And there's no one in Montrose. I assure you, there was no one back here as well. But she had heard about this man called Jesus. And that need for her to have her daughter free from such was driving her, was putting that faith to work. Number three, obstacle, Satan was against her. The Bible says, for one of his demons had taken control in her own life, in her life, her daughter's life. So how are you going to fight that? What help agency is there to help her with that? Satan was against her. Number four, the disciples were against her. Note in the second part of verse 26 that she kept asking. And in the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 15, 23, when we were there, we learned that his disciples urged Jesus to send her away. Could you imagine if you came here with a problem and the ushers came and you wanted to come and see one of our pastors and the usher was saying, guys, send these people away. Why? Because they keep asking for things. That wouldn't be a nice picture for anyone. Well, we learned in Matthew when we were there that the disciples wanted Jesus to send her away. And fifthly, lastly, for a time it even seems that Jesus was against her. In Matthew 15, verse 23, he did not answer her a word. And you think, well, why didn't he answer her a word? Well, who is this woman? Is she a Jew? Right? She's not a Jew. And in Matthew, how did she approach Jesus? She approached him, Son of David, right? If you remember, Lord. Now, how would it look if I went up here to Wolf's Ranch or Wolf's Cattle Company or one of our ranches over there like this, and I went and said, howdy. You know, if I try to speak cowboy, you know, how do you think they would, you think they would look at me like, oh my goodness, what a weirdo. The bus must have dropped this guy off or something, right? How do you do that? How would you look if you went into Tortilla Flats or something like that, and we had all the Chicanos right there with their lowriders, and they're like this, bandanas, mustaches, and stuff like that, playing oldies, and you went, hola, muchachos. You think you're communicating? Let me tell you something. When she came out, this Greek woman, this Syrophoenician, and said, son of David, you do not think the disciples are looking at her like, who is this woman? Jesus, in Matthew, wasn't even talking to her. Not even talking to her. And so the guys took this as, he's done. Send her away, Lord. Send her away. Now, would you not agree with me that those are obstacles? Those are huge obstacles for this woman, this poor mama, to have to overcome so that the Lord would do something for her daughter. What are your obstacles? What are your friends' obstacles that they have? See, unless these stories were here, how would we be encouraged to move forward and to continue to go through whatever we have to go through to come to Jesus? Church, the last part of verse 25 states that she came and fell at his feet. So that's where she's at. That's where she's speaking from. She's at the feet of Jesus. And the last part of verse 26, note, it states that she kept asking him to cast the demon out of her daughter. Verse 27, but Jesus said to her, let the children be filled first. Oh man, we can stop right there. If you were desperate and you were asking for something and Jesus didn't say no, because he's not saying no. All he is saying is, let the children be filled first. I would take that. I would be encouraged. I would latch on to that because he didn't say no to me. He's probably saying, hey, Ben, can you just wait a little bit? Let me take care of what I have to take care of. Would you not be encouraged with that? Oh, my gosh. You know, oh, my gosh, there's something here. You know, church, this is an encouragement to a mom who has no other hope. Now listen to me, church. Great faith takes hold of even the slightest encouragement and turns it into a fulfilled promise. That's what great faith does. Now think about this. Think about it this way. You're out here on one of our trails and you slip and you're falling off the cliff. And you can't pick yourself up. And you're looking down and it's a long ways down. And there's ice out there right now. And all of a sudden you realize, I can't pick myself up. Like a person who's drowning or a person who has no other hope, you realize that as soon as your hands, as soon as your muscles cannot hold you, you're done. And all of a sudden you hear, take my hand, take my hand. And you see a hand come out to you. That's where all of a sudden your hope turns. Your hope turns to that person that's going to bring you. This is what she received from Jesus. This is what happens with her. She takes hold of this hope. The slightest encouragement, but it's something for her. Jesus did not say no. He said, let the children be filled first. Second observation, the children. Who are we talking about? The children that must be filled first, church, are the Israelites. They are God's chosen people. He committed the scriptures to them. He dwelt with them in the tabernacle and later on in the temple. So they were privileged and God made awesome covenants with them. By contrast, or the opposite, the Gentiles were according to Ephesians chapter 2, verse 11 and 12, quote, aliens from the commonwealth of Israel and strangers from the covenant of promise, having no hope without God in the world, end of quote. Church, yes, the Lord came primarily to the nation of Israel. He presented himself as king to that nation. The gospel was first preached to the house of Israel. So it is important for us to see this in order to understand his dealings with the Syrophoenician woman. So Jesus said to her, let the children be filled first, for it is not good to take the children's bread and throw it to the little dogs. Church, one more observation here. Note that Jesus refers to the Jews as children. How many of your children were just born mature? How many of you guys have five-year-olds and eight-year-olds that are just the most mature little kids around, right? Not really, right? Our kids at 2 years old in the nursery, they start fighting over the toys. You give them a little cookie and they steal it from one another. I mean, it's amazing, right? So Jesus, or God, Jesus right now speaking of the Jews as children. He says, he refers to them as children. And the Gentiles, he refers to them as little dogs. What's a little dog? A puppy. A puppy that wants to learn. A puppy that has needs. A puppy that won't leave you alone. Little puppies. Church, he does not refer to the Gentiles here as ravenous dogs, although there were some among the Jewish leadership that did. Stay away from those Gentiles. They're dogs. You know, they're going to bite you. You know, but Jesus doesn't do that here, right? He speaks to them in kindness, and he speaks of them with kindness. 28. So he says this to her, and look at her answer, 28. And she answered and said to him, "Yes, Lord, yet even the little dogs under the table eat from the children's crumbs." Wow. 29. Then he said to her, "For this saying, go your way. The demon has gone out of your daughter." And when she had come to her house, she found the demon gone out and her daughter lying on the bed. Could you imagine? Right? So she gets home. She comes home and opens the door and goes to the next room where her little daughter was asleep. He opens the door and she says, "Mom, Mom, you're not going to believe what happened to me." First of all, her countenance, perhaps. She's noticing her countenance. I don't know what demon-possessed kids look like. I think I've seen some in Montrose, but I'm still not sure, okay? But he goes and he sees her. Mama knows the difference. Mama knows when something has happened. And she comes home and there she is. Oh, my word. I can only imagine she said, "It's worth it. It is worth going through the obstacles. My daughter has been set free. It's true about this man called Jesus. It's true that he even cares for us who aren't Jews, who don't know any better, who are the unchurched. It's so true about this guy." And it's amazing what that family, perhaps their reunion. Her reply, I want to focus on this. How she answered her reply, because it just blows us away. Observe, church, number one, she did not deny that special place of the children, the Jews in God's plan. She could have. She could have said a number of things, but she didn't deny it. She's not arguing with him. Sometimes we want to argue, huh? Second observation in her reply, she did not complain that God favoring them, the Jews, wasn't fair. How many of us say, "It's not fair. How come they get all the breaks and we don't get all the breaks? It's not fair." She's nowhere there. See, a lot of us, especially as an American society, we feel entitled. We feel entitled. How come they get the jobs? How come they get insurance? How come they get this and that? Why are we left out in the cold? And we have this feeling of entitlement that has come over us. You don't pick it up with her. Third observation. All she asked was for crumbs. Crumbs. Not a piece, not a morsel, just a crumb. Just a crumb, right? Perhaps she had heard how Jesus again had fed the 5,000 people that didn't have any food. And then after it was said and done, 12 baskets of all kinds of fragrance and fish and bread were picked up. This man is powerful. I don't want to feed 5,000. I don't even need 12 baskets. My need is just that if Jesus would just give me one little crumb, one little thing, and I know my daughter would be set free. That's what she's hoping for. That's her faith. We know that Jesus' blood cleanses us from all unrighteousness. Now think about this. Even if his body bled out 2,000 years ago, we are millions that have come to him. How powerful is his blood? How powerful is this man called Jesus? And at his word, one little word, one little turn, one little look, grace going out, power going out, her daughter would be made whole. She believed this. She believed her daughter could be delivered. Church, it must have brought even a smile to Jesus' face. Think about this. It must have brought a smile to his face. And certainly to the disciples, they must have looked amazed. Did she just say that? Did you hear what she just said? When they heard her take Jesus' very words and use them as a basis for her plea. She says, "Yes, Lord, yet even the little dogs under the table eat from the children's crumbs." Jesus must have just turned around and just says, "Wow, woman." The guys must have said, "It's amazing. Look at her." She accepted her place, church. She believed his word, and she persisted in her plea. And Jesus not only met her need, but also commended her for her faith. Church, when we first read this account, again, it might seem that Jesus was being difficult with this obvious hurting mom who, again, against all the obstacles we just mentioned, persisted in her plea. But he wasn't. He wasn't. No, he was drawing from her what faith she did have, that little faith that she did have, that not only would be rewarded, of course, in the deliverance of her daughter, but that faith would prove to be the starting point, a catalyst, if you may, for a relationship with God. Do you not think that they went home and from that point on, she would talk about this man called Jesus, the little that she knew? Do you not think that she said, "Honey, you have to thank the Lord. Mama, but tell me about the Lord." "Well, I don't know that much about him, but this is what I can tell you. I heard that he's healing people. I heard that he's made miracles and has made food for everyone. We need to find out more about Jesus." You see, that little part of faith sparked a relationship. That's why Jesus would draw faith out of us. You might be here today, and you might have a little bit of faith. What God wants from you is a relationship. He wants a relationship, so he can, it all depends on you. Are you seeking him out? Fulfill that desire that you have or meet that need that you have. But it's not just so that you could run away and enjoy and be healed or be freed or whatever. He wants a relationship with you, a lasting relationship with you. Perhaps there's an application for you from this passage. As we looked at the context, as we saw the story, what does that mean for me today? How can that help me today? What can I take home with me? Well, perhaps think about this. Have you thought or wondered as to why it seems that the Lord has been difficult with you? Are you here today and saying, "Well, huh, he takes care of the Greeks, takes care of the Jews, but what about me?" Are you thinking perhaps that God has been difficult with you? From this passage, perhaps you're thinking, "Why is it that he hasn't answered my prayers like right now or yet? Why hasn't he answered my prayers yet?" Perhaps you're thinking, "Why isn't he helping me presently? Why isn't he helping me presently?" Church, from this passage, perhaps it could be that the Lord is doing something much more deeper with you. Perhaps your relationship has stalled with the Lord. Perhaps your relationship has plateaued and it's just going across. It's almost dead because you let some things go. You let your affection for him go. You've lost your first love. You were in love with Jesus one time. You didn't care who knew. You bragged on him all the time, but perhaps lately or recently, it's kind of like, "Well, I don't know." And yet you need him and you want from him. Perhaps it seems that he's difficult with you because he wants to do that work. He wants you to come back to him. He wants you to return to your first love. Perhaps there's a mom here today. A mom here among us. Certainly this presentation from Life Choices and our presentation has spoken to you. And I love that they have a class about learning to accept that forgiveness and moving on with your life. Not that that will ever go away, but my goodness, turn it around. If you're stroking the cat backwards and the cat's, turn the cat around and stroke it the right way, right? And that's how it should be with us. Yes, there's issues in our life that have messed us up. We have regrets in our life. None of us are perfect. But you could turn that around to bring God the honor and glory, through realizing that you have been saved, you have been set free. Again, perhaps there's a mother here today that is concerned for a child. If so, realize, mama, realize from the passage we have just read and consider that Jesus is just a prayer away. Jesus is here to help you. And church, perhaps there's someone here today that, like this Gentile who did not know the true God, yet you have heard enough from others how Jesus has changed a life. And perhaps your life needs a change. Perhaps you consider yourself an outsider. You consider yourself a non-religious person. And so you're asking, will Jesus hear my cry? Will he have mercy on me? What's the answer, church? Absolutely so. Yes, Jesus will hear your cry. Yes, he will have mercy on you. The answer is yes. All things that he did, all things that he does, are always a response to faith. Faith. The Bible says, but without faith, it is impossible to please him. For he who comes to God must believe that he is, and that he is a rewarder of those who diligently seek him. Have you diligently sought out the Lord? From verse 25, we learn that she came and fell at his feet. Perhaps you should do the same and cry out to him today. If he met her request, believe that he will do the same for you. Persistent prayer is rewarded. Amen. We won't get to the next story until next week. I hope you're here with us, and we'll cover that part of Scripture as well. Would you bow your